Welcome to Business 101. My name is Barb Atrops. I'm with the Auburn Downtown Association. And I believe we have a great lineup of experts today to help you out with your financial questions about setting up your business, accounting-wise and financially and insurance-wise. Very important building blocks for your business. I want to thank the City of Auburn, especially Mayor Nancy Backus and the City Council for their ongoing support of this effort, and also the Auburn Area Chamber of Commerce, and of course the Auburn Downtown Association that I represent. So first up is Maria Bogosius. She's a small business accounting consultant with Fitchett, Benedict & Clark. And she has a lot of experience with QuickBooks, over 20 years experience. She's also an instructor at Green River Community College, and now she offers her services through Fitchett, Benedict, and Clark. And if you have any questions for Maria, there'll be a question and answer period following the presentations. So enjoy, and here's Maria.
Thank you, Barb, and thank you for coming. I also want to thank those of you who are logging on to the website and watching this on the video. There's some great videos there to reference. So one of the things we wanted to talk to you about today is being proactive and setting up your accounting system correctly when you're starting a small business. So is what I have done is I have structured this presentation into down to 10 basic questions to ask yourself. And for those of you that are watching online, this list of 10 questions is available on our website too in our white papers. It's fbc-cpa.com. So one of the first things you need to know is what is your entity type? When you first plan on starting a business, you need to do a lot of research. You need to figure out what is best for you. A sole proprietor is obviously the simplest, but sometimes there's some liability issues in there and you may not want to be a sole proprietor. You can be a partnership with one or more partners, or you can be an S-corp or a C-corporation. Now, an S-corporation means small businesses, and there's a great tax benefit to that. And I have on my slide here, it says wages versus distributions, self-employment tax, tax rates, now and in the future. So if you want to meet with a CPA or a financial advisor, they can give you some ideas on how those tax breaks work for a corporate officer. Once you decide what entity type you're going to be, you need to register with several agencies. And the order in which you set these accounts up is important. The first one for people in Washington State, you want to make sure that you, if you're going to become an LLC or a corporation, you need to make sure that your corporate name that you've chosen has not been used. So you need to first register with the Secretary of State. Then once you get approved and you get your number from the Secretary of State, then you could go ahead and file it's called a SS4 request for an EIN. That's with the IRS. Once you get that, then you can go ahead on the third step and register with the Department of Revenue. Now, when you register with the Department of Revenue for a business application and a master business license, they will want to know, do you plan on hiring employees? So the first thing you need to decide is, do I want to hire employees? Do I know all the laws and regulations pertaining to employees? The payroll taxes, the labor laws, the liabilities, etc. Those are a good thing to know. Maybe your business, you're going to just start out small and run it yourself. Then you won't have to worry about the payroll issues. But if you are hiring employees right off the bat, when you file your application with the State Department of Revenue, they're going to also notify Labor and Industries and Employment Security and get those accounts set up. One thing a lot of people don't know if they don't have an accounting background is, how should I keep my books, on a cash basis or an accrual basis? And this can be very crucial depending on the type of business you're in. If you choose the wrong one, sometimes it could just about put your business under. So cash basis is when you record your income and your expenses according to the date that the cash changes hands. Accrual basis is a document date driven system. So when you issue an invoice to a customer, that is the date that you record that income, not when they pay you. And that's the part right there that can catch a lot of people off guard, because you're paying taxes before you actually get paid from your customer. How much accounting do I need to know? Okay, most people go into business because there's something they do really good. They're passionate about something. And they say, you know what, I'm going to start my own business doing this. Okay, but that doesn't mean that you know business in general. So there's a few basic things you need to find out before you take your expertise on the road. And one of the things is that Mark's going to be talking about when he gets to the loan information, is you need to have accurate financial statements. You need to know what the difference between a balance sheet, a profit and loss, and a cash flow statement are. You need to know how to read those. And they're the documents that the loan officers are going to be looking at. So a balance sheet is all of your assets, what you own, all of your liabilities, what you owe, and then the net worth of your company or your equity. Those items, when you print out a balance sheet, it's on a specific day. It's a snapshot, one day in time. And those numbers keep rolling forward year to year, kind of like your checkbook. It doesn't just start over again on January 1st. It keeps rolling. Now, a profit and loss statement, it has two dates, a beginning date and an end date. And it covers a range of time, a time period. So it's going to be for the fiscal year, for the month, for the quarter. And so you'll always have two dates there. When you get to your end of your fiscal year, your profit and loss goes to zero and starts over. And then the cash flow statement, that's kind of like the piece that completes the three-piece puzzle. It shows you how your cash goes from your equity and your assets and how it's generated from your income, and it's kind of like the piece in between. Okay, when you file with the Department of Revenue, one of the things you want to know is, what is my industry type requirements? And am I required to collect and remit sales tax? I've seen some businesses that don't realize, oh, I just have a service. I'm not selling a product, so I don't have to charge sales tax. Well, there are some businesses that are strictly a service labor type business, and they are required to collect sales tax. So you don't want to get caught off guard with that one. You want to make sure you do your research and find out. You all may also have multiple categories to report. So research your specific industry and know what the requirements are before you jump in. Okay, one of the biggest things that people are afraid of is getting audited. And if you know how to audit proof your business, it's really not that scary. Mostly it's all about keeping the right documentation, knowing what records to keep, what kind of detail to keep. Okay, one of the things I always tell people now, that you get so many of these receipts that are on thermal paper. Well, if you ever put one, you know, in a drawer somewhere or leave it in your car and it gets too hot, you go back and look at it, it's either a solid black or white, and there's nothing there. So if the receipt is important enough to keep, you want to make sure you either photocopy it or scan it, so that way you have it permanently. Because if you get audited, it's probably not going to be for 3-4 years down the road. So some of those receipts may disintegrate by the time you're ready to go back and look at them. There's also some other rules about what kind of documentation to get or to keep. And one of the things that I've seen many small businesses do is they'll charge everything on business credit cards, and then they'll just keep their statements and not their receipts. Okay, you can get caught by that because when an auditor comes in to see what you've purchased, they want to see the actual receipt. They don't want to see just the statement. So there's some little things like that you need to know to audit proof your business. What kind of accounting system should I use? Well, like Barb said, I personally have been working with QuickBooks for 20 years. I've helped hundreds of businesses get set up and use this. It is used by 90% of the small businesses in the United States, which is pretty huge. And it's because of its flexibility and its ease in use. Really, it's easy to use. It's just a little tricky sometimes setting it up. But there's so much flexibility with this. And depending on your business and what your requirements are as far as auditing and record keeping, this is flexible enough to accommodate those things. What professional advice should I seek when I start my business? Well, when you're starting your business, everything you spend is an investment. Don't think of it as an expense. When you get started on the right foot and you get good advice and good help, it's going to keep you from making mistakes that could be costly down the road. So make sure whether it's an accountant, whether it's an attorney, whether it's somebody like Marshall that is in insurance, you want to make sure your business is covered. And you, whatever type of expert you need, maybe it's an IT professional, maybe it's a web designer. If you're taking orders online, you want to make sure you have a good website that's going to attract and also is easy to use for the customers that log into that. So like I said, some of the suggestions are be proactive in researching your industry. Research the competition. What's working for them? What isn't working for them? And what can you offer your customers that your competitor can't? You know, that's the key, is finding out what makes you special, what makes you the person that they want to call instead of your competition. Don't be afraid to ask for help. And like I was saying before, some people are really good at some skill or some type of service or whatever it is that they're doing, but sometimes they don't know business itself. And it's really sad. Over the years, I've seen a lot of people who their businesses actually fail because they don't know how to run and manage the business. But they're really good at what they do. And they end up getting caught up in, you know, tax problems or, you know, other kind of managerial problems. And it's so sad because they're awesome at what they do. And so I always try to help people avoid those pitfalls. One of the reasons, one of the top 10 reasons that some businesses fail is lack of good management and lack of a good accounting system, and also lack of financial planning. So when you do start your business, or maybe you're already into it a couple years, and you find yourself needing some, maybe a small business loan, you need to make sure that you have a plan and you have different ideas as far as, okay, well, if this doesn't quite work out, what is my plan B? You know, when you go to see your loan officer, if they ask you a question, well, what if that doesn't work out? You want to have an answer, a response to that. Identify your strengths and your weaknesses that could contribute to your success or your failure. You know, if there's something that you just personally don't like to do, you hate doing bookkeeping. Well, then that's going to be a problem, because as an owner of a business, you need to do the bookkeeping. And if you don't want to do it or you can't do it, make sure you delegate that to somebody, whether it's a family member, whether you hire an employee, but make sure that those important tasks are delegated to somebody. And once again, don't try to be an expert at everything. You can't wear all the hats. You know, you're the owner and you control who does what in your company. So it doesn't mean you have to do everything. Even if it's just hiring a consultant to come in and get you started on the right track, then do that, because that'll be an investment in the future. Develop procedures and schedules for all aspects of your business. A well-run business will basically have a written procedure for every single thing they do, step by step. So if something happened to you or you weren't available and they had to do something, there's a procedure manual that's going to give them step-by-step instructions on how to do this when nobody's around to help them. And having procedures in place like this is going to help you to avoid missing deadlines, lost sales, missed appointments, and you also might want to make sure you follow up with customers and potential customers on a timely basis. And most of all, when you're starting your own business, you want to choose success over failure. You want to have fun. You're doing this business because you're passionate about this business, not because you just didn't have anything else to do. You know, if that was the case, you'd probably still be working for somebody else. So make sure you get started on the right track. And any questions? So I do have some of these resources online with fbc-cpa.com. I have a list for those of you that are watching online. You can go get the list of 10 questions off of the FBC website. It's in the white paper section. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Maria, for the excellent wisdom. It was a great overview of the importance of getting your financial basics in order. So next up, we have Marshall Klontz with HBT Insurance. And a lot of people don't know that HBT has been around town since the 1930s. And his family purchased the business in 1987. So well-known local company to do your insurance and seek advice. So please welcome Marshall as he explains all the details of your business insurance. Thank you.
Thank you. Kind of stole my intro there, but we can work with it. As she said, my name is Marshall Klontz with HBT Insurance. HBT was founded by three men named Hill, Banchero, and Twite in 1936. It was then sold in 1987 to my dad, Bob Klontz, and his partner, Bill Cowart. They took it from a two-man operation working in the back of a boat store to now, I think, 25 employees, and we're right over on Auburn Way. We also handle mortgages as well. Here's our clicker. Today we're going to be going over how do you get insurance, how every business requires a different policy that is individual and unique to it. We're going to talk about what you are covered for. We're going to talk about how you make your premium go down in the long run. We're going to talk a little bit about how honesty and communication are key between you and your agent. And then I have an example quote that I provided for you that I think everyone got. It was sitting at the back. And then we'll take any questions. So first off, how do you get insurance? Well, you need to call an agent, and I would highly recommend not doing it online. Insurance is an ever-changing business that we as agents have to go through at least 32 extra credit hours every 2 years just to maintain our licenses, and you obviously don't want to take those classes, so feel free to call me. You can call a local State Farm, an Allstate, or any of those direct writers, and they have the ability to get you insurance, but it will be through only State Farm or Allstate. With independent agents like HBT Insurance, we have the ability to work with multitude of carriers. I think HBT personally works with over 90 separate carriers, so we can get you Travelers, Safeco, Liberty, The Hartford, which is what this quote is. So you really have more options out there. Don't pigeonhole yourself and allow yourself to be sucked in by the big advertising schemes on TV, because they can handle a lot of things, but we can handle more. So when you start, you make that call, there's going to be a little bit of an information interview. What we're going to need to know is your address, your business name, a little bit of your past experience, and really what you need to be covered. That'll vary from your property, your income, and the risk that you are yourself, what you're doing. From that point, we'll send it in. We'll give you a quote submission, which everyone wants it to be that day, that minute, that next day. And this can take anywhere from 5 to 10 days. And if it takes longer than that, feel free to call your agent back. After that, we'll receive a quote proposal, and we'll present that to you. We'll go over it and make sure what you guys have, what you need covered, and make sure we're providing you all the right services for the right price. And at that point, it will be submitted for binding. And at the point of binding, you as an entity have coverage and are insured. And then we're going to talk about how every business is different. And every business is referred to as a risk with the carriers. So they are truly taking a risk by insuring you. You're giving them a premium every year, and they're going to provide you 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 times the amount of coverage for that dollar amount that you pay them. So you are truly a risk. And every risk is rated on either a payroll or a sales basis. There at the bottom it says that Liberty Mutual is a great writer of contractors. They rate you on a risk basis of employees and payroll. So the more people that you as a contractor have in the field, is the larger your risk is, because the more work that's being done. Whereas if you're a general store on the corner, your risk is going to be rated versus sales. It doesn't necessarily matter how many employees you have. That's okay. I think that's happened to me plenty of times. So if you're a general store on the corner, similar to what this proposal's for, you'll be rated on a sales basis, to where you don't necessarily have a risk by adding more employees because you're not expanding, you're not doing more work, but your sales are the more products that are sent out the door that you're liable for, to where as soon as you sell that product, it's now your product. You're not just going to be able to delegate back to the original company that you purchased it from. You've put your name on that by selling it and sending it out the door. And then when we begin to speak with you, we're trying to figure out what could happen. What is the biggest issue that could present itself with your business, and what can we cover you for? Insurance, a lot of people like to think of it as we're preparing you for a catastrophe. It's not the little thing that you can get out your checkbook for, but it is truly a catastrophe. If your building burns down, if your business is shut down, that's what we're here for. We want to be able to get you guys back in business and make sure that you're not losing money and you're not affected. What is covered? And this comes back to the title of this presentation. It's who you are and what you do. You as an individual and as a business are covered, because people, when they're not happy with what you do or what you sell, are going to come after you, and they like that $1 million number, which is why we give you guys $1 million in coverage for the most part. And what you do, whether it be a service or a sale, we're covering that product that you put out. And then I talked about how carriers will vary, and Liberty Professional Contractors, Hartford Professional Liability, there's a lot of different carriers out there that will be significantly different in what they like. Their Travelers is a company that is very specific in what they write, and they'll only write apartment buildings that are built after 1990. If it's 1989, they won't do it. So don't feel like you have to be with one specific carrier. There's always another option, and there's always another route. So what are you covered for? We talked about this a little bit in the past, and this will also come into that initial interview. What you own, and this will be referred to as business personal property, or BPP. That is your inventory, your tables, desks, and chairs, everything that you own that you've put into that business, where if it burnt down, what dollar amount do you need to get back? And then there's the slip, trip, and fall, or general liability, where a lot of people say, oh, I just need liability. But they don't realize that if they don't have business personal property covered, every table, desk, chair, and computer that they put into that business will not be covered. And slip, trip, and fall is when someone walks into your building, if you left a wet floor or you left a shoe laying around or anything, if they could say that you're negligent in that area that allowed them to be injured or hurt, that's where your general liability comes in. And most of the time, it'll be covered on a $1 million occurrence basis and a $2 million aggregate basis, to where you could have two $1 million losses in a year, or a whole bunch of $50 losses, which I would not recommend that. Don't claim those. But your aggregate is the most amount of money that can be paid out within 1 year. And to go above and beyond that, you would purchase what's called an umbrella, which can be based on $1 million limits. You could go $1 million, $2 million, $3 million, all the way up to $50 million in extra coverage. And what an umbrella does is it wraps over your general liability, it wraps over your business personal property, and if you also have autos on the policy as well, you'd be covered in that situation, to where someone who has a minor infraction and dings somebody and then they have whiplash can't come back and take your entire business for an auto-related event. And then we talked about your work, that product that you put out, whether it be the sale or the service, that's also what's going to be covered down the line. How do I make my premiums go down? This is a question that I get asked every single day, and it will never, ever, ever happen. Premiums go up 1 to 3% on average every year, and the best way to keep them from going up even more is to not have claims. Do not, if you can handle something individually and it's not going to put you in a catastrophic event, Make sure you take care of that, because the more claims you have, they'll rack up, they'll hurt you in the long run. You'll be paying 2-3 times what you initially paid, and you're put yourself at a risk of being dropped. And then if you always have the option as the insured, this is something that people don't necessarily know, is that you can shop at any time throughout the year. You have the ability to change carriers, to change agents. As the insured, you rest with all the power. And like I said, honesty and communication are key. Incorrect information will lead to an audit that we spoke about earlier. And in an audit, they'll always want to know how much you sold, what did you do, and they want to make sure you didn't have any losses, that you didn't turn into them. If you allow for incorrect information and you have a catastrophic event, if you didn't want to pay more, so you listed a smaller amount of business personal property, you're not going to get that money back. For a small dollar amount in the beginning, you're going to be hurting in the long run. Insurance is always expensive until you need it. And then business safety. If you don't present the right information at the right time, your business is at a huge risk of not being covered, and you could lose that business that you've put your heart, effort, time, and money into. So honesty and communication with your agent, always key, and that allows us to do our job in finding you the right market. Then we have the example quote. This was an example quote that I put together this morning. It's with the Hartford Insurance Agency. It's for a general store that you could find anywhere. I actually use my home address, so feel free to disregard that. Then flip to the second page, and this is the property coverage that we talked about. This is your business personal property. It goes, and people think that, oh, your property's just coverage. There are so many endorsements and additional coverages that are in this, that as long as you maintain your ability to stay with a standard carrier, no claims, then you'll be allowed so much more coverage for a lower price. You have coverages that vary from accounts receivable, and that's typically a $25,000 number, to where you have $25,000 in coverage, protection, and backing by the insurance carrier to go and refund that money that you have not been paid by your customers. There are coverages of monies and securities. If you have money on hand at your business, as long as it's locked up and protected reasonably, you'll have money to go back and subrogate against another individual to find that money. You have newly acquired or constructed property, where I know everyone's not always the most honest at the right time. So if you go and you buy a new business, you buy a new location, you buy a new property, you'll have coverage for that additional property for up to 180 days. For a set limit at a set time. You have your signs, your glass, your valuable papers. That's something that a lot of people aren't always aware of. They have everything recorded. They're very, very careful with what they do and how they place it, but there's always a risk. There's always a potential to lose it. And so with insurance, you have the ability to protect yourself for your valuable papers and records. We can go to more property coverage. And I believe you're opening a new brewery, right? So we've got equipment breakdown, and everything you have is the most valuable thing there, because if it doesn't work, you can't produce beer. So we have equipment breakdown, you have your boiler, so you have explosion of steam equipment. You're covered for water damage or loss due to hazardous substances. Anything that would have to do with your property, you can find a coverage for. Then there's liability, and that's what we talked about with the slip, trip, and fall. You have, like I said, typically a $1 million, $2 million limit. And there's lots of different dollar amounts that are acquired within there. There's defense costs. If someone came at you in your business saying that you did something wrong or you were not true to your word and how you worked, that's where that $1 million of defense comes in. The company will provide a lawyer, will provide coverage up to that $1 million limit to protect you and your entity, because they don't want a loss on their record. There's a couple things down here that as new business owners you need to know about in every situation, especially if you're going to have employees. Washington State Stopgap is our form of workers' compensation. You're not liable to buy that workers' compensation ahead of time, as the state L&I takes care of it, but you need to make sure you have this stopgap, because in a situation where an employee was hurt and had to miss work, like Aflac always says, you are protected. You have the ability to take care of yourself, because L&I might say that you were the negligent party and you caused injury to that employee, and if they had to pay out on your behalf, they will always come back to collect that money from you. They don't like giving out their own money. And so if you have the stopgap coverage, you take care of yourself and protect yourself to allow yourself to have that security later. Another thing that a lot of people don't have on theirs is hired and non-owned auto liability, and that's where if you have an employee who is maybe running to the bank, and they're not driving a company car, they're not on a personal auto policy. If they're running to the bank and they get in an accident, and the individual they hit goes, "What were you doing? Why were you going so fast?" They say, "Oh, I was running to the bank for go." And they say, "Oh, we're going to go find them, and we're going to take money from them, because that company always has more money than that individual." And that hired and auto liability provides you that protection. Their primary insurance is always going to be the first one to pay, but if they can't cover the loss, they're always going to go after the company. And as long as you have hired and non-owned, they're not going to be able to get you. Let's see if we have anything else on here. There is another big one is employment practices and liability. And that is every time you have an employee, you open yourself up to risk. That employee has the ability to make a claim about you at any time, and you can't always control it. Employment-related practices liability is going to give you $1 million of coverage if they say that you didn't do something right, wrongful hiring and firing, molestation and abuse, things that you would never dream of doing as an employer, but someone always has the ability to say that you did. So that's another big one that you need to make sure you have on there if you have employees. There are a few other coverages throughout this that cover things that you may never think of or believe you need, but you have the ability. Fine arts, forgery, outdoor signs, even temperature change. If your business was to be affected by temperature change, which is a very big topic right now, then you have coverage for that. There are a few other things on there that if you have questions about at all, feel free to ask me right now or afterwards. I'd be more than happy to answer them. But I think that takes us pretty well through this policy and insurance as a whole. So I thank you guys for your time. And do you have any questions right now? Thank you.
Thank you, Marshall, for your excellent insider tips. From a consumer perspective, I think you really gave us some good information, and I think we are definitely ready to go out and shop for insurance and know what questions to ask. Very important. So next up is Mark Costello with the Small Business Administration. He's been with SBA for over 20 years. And so if you have any needs in terms of borrowing money, the government has a lot of good options. And so Mark's going to talk about that.
Terrific. Thanks for the introduction and for the opportunity to be here, you guys. I appreciate it. So I'm with the Small Business Administration. We're actually an agency of the federal government, and we have a kind of a neat mission in that we exist in order to provide programs and services to support small businesses. And so that is kind of a unique thing. What I want to do today is talk a little bit about some of those services, particularly with regard to financing. But in addition to that, I want to touch on sort of the range of opportunities that are available to people that are maybe looking to start a business or expand their businesses by accessing some of the organizations that SBA has relationships with or partnerships with. I think one of the neat things is in some of the earlier comments, there was some discussion about ways that people go about developing maybe their business idea and plan and so on, and the different kinds of professionals that they're oftentimes going to tap into in order to go about that process. And I think one of the hopefully one of the takeaways for you guys here today and for the people that might be watching online is that there are some opportunities out there for people to get really quality assistance and it doesn't have to cost anything. So there are a couple of key organizations that I want to talk a little bit about just to make sure you guys are aware that you don't necessarily have to pay a whole bunch of money for people to advise you on the development of your business plan. So with that, let me go ahead and see if I can work through my slides and certainly encourage any questions that you might have along the way or certainly at the end. So I want to talk just a little bit about what our agency does overall. I want to focus in specifically on the financing piece of SBA, and particularly I want to talk about what we call the 7A Guaranteed Loan Program, which more than likely is the source of funding that most businesses would end up with if they're going to get an SBA-backed loan. It's going to generally be through this particular program. As I mentioned, I want to talk about some of the other opportunities that are available to businesses working through the different organizations that we partner with. I want to talk a little bit about maybe in a more general way, the idea of getting funding from a lender, whether it's an SBA guaranteed loan or some other kind of financing. I think one of the things that I've noted is lenders have sort of a set criteria for the most part of things that are important to them, things that they're going to be looking for when they sit down with a potential client, and things that are key in their decision as to whether or not to provide financing. So I want to touch on that a little bit so that you guys have something to maybe think about if you get to the point where you're ready to interact with a lender. You'll have a better sense, I hope, as a result of our conversation today, of what it is that lenders are really driven by when they make their decisions as far as whether or not to provide financing to small businesses. So let's go ahead and just talk a little bit more about SBA. And in addition to financing and backing SBA loans that I'm going to talk about, we kind of like to talk about our offerings in what we call the three C's. And so we're, in addition to talking about capital, which happens to be my particular area of responsibility, SBA has also got resources available to people that are looking for counseling and training opportunities. And in particular, a couple of the organizations I wanted to make mention of, and I think there's a slide a little farther along that has some website information, but I wanted to talk about on the sort of counseling and training side, a couple of key relationships that we have. By that, I mean that we provide some funding for these organizations, and so they do a lot of the important sort of ground level counseling and advising to the different small businesses out there, people who are looking to start businesses. One such organization is SCORE. And SCORE is a group of volunteer business advisors and mentors. These are folks that generally have got small business management backgrounds. They have an opportunity now to maybe give back a little bit and provide what generally is going to be quality, one-on-one, always confidential, no cost counseling to people that are looking to start businesses, maybe kick around a potential business idea, or people that are ready to go into business. Maybe they've got a business plan and they're looking to refine it a little bit. There's an opportunity here to work with this organization, SCORE, to get some objective feedback and have somebody that you can bounce ideas around with in order to get to that next level, whether it's taking your idea and converting it into an actionable plan, whether it's taking your plan and converting that and moving you forward to being in business, or whether it's being in business now and kind of going to the next level. These people have resources and backgrounds that would put them in a position to be able to help you out with that. They also do an ongoing series of workshops. The Seattle chapter of SCORE, which is co-located with our office, and it kind of runs, I think, every 2 months. One of them's on building a business plan. One of them's on marketing a business. One's on sort of the nuts and bolts of starting a business. These are generally all-day workshops. They throw in a box lunch, and I think they charge you $65 for the whole thing, but it can be a very worthwhile proposition if you're, you know, again, somebody that's kind of looking to get to that next level, or just get your thoughts together and figure out what exactly is involved in starting a business here in, say, King County. We have a couple of other organizations in addition to SCORE. If you're in business now, there's a group called the Small Business Development Center. which is a network of what I would consider to be paid professional business advisors, but they're partly funded by SBA. There are probably four or five of these counseling centers located in the greater Seattle area. There's one down in Tacoma, and there's one or two here in Kent and Auburn. Kirk Davis is one gentleman that comes to mind, who I believe is an outstanding advisor. And their assistance, again, is available at no cost to you guys as business owners. They'll work with you on a one-time basis or on an ongoing basis, depending upon what your needs are. If you're maybe somebody who's looking to kind of develop some projections or maybe research a particular business concept, I think the Small Business Development Center would be a great option for you. If you're somebody who's in business now and maybe you're looking at expansion ideas, the Small Business Development Center, it would be a great option for that as well. If you're somebody that's in business now and you're struggling maybe and trying to figure out just exactly what the issues are, these are folks that have the kinds of backgrounds. Again, a lot of them have run businesses, own their own businesses. They have some academic credentials that put them in a pretty good position to give you or to be able to give you the kind of assistance that might be really useful in any of those situations. A couple of other sort of resources out there that are partners with SBA. We have something called the Women's Business Center. Women business owners in particular can take advantage of this network. There are two women's business centers on the west side of the state, one in Seattle, one happens to be in Thurston County in Lacey. They do the same kind of thing. Their mission and really passion, I think, is to help entrepreneurs, and they're available to work with people at any stage of the business life cycle at a no-cost kind of a basis, confidential. They do training as well as mentoring. So WBC, Women's Business Center, would be another acronym to kind of keep in mind in terms of resources. And finally, we actually have, if there are any veterans out there in the community that might be looking to go into business or expanding their business, there's something called the Veteran Business Outreach Center. SBA also provides some funding for that. It's located also in Seattle. VBOC is the acronym. They do the same kind of thing in terms of they're available to work with, in this case, veteran-owned businesses or veteran entrepreneurs or would-be entrepreneurs on a one-on-one confidential basis for whatever their particular business need is. So there's this sort of range of different support organizations out there affiliated or associated with SBA that I think it's important for people to kind of keep in mind when they're looking at, hey, how can I get some help? That's the secret. I think it's a little known in some cases because we don't have a big marketing budget, I guess. But the fact of the matter is these things are out there, and it's great to have an opportunity here today to bring this up and share it with you guys. If you're somebody that is providing a service or a product that might be of interest to the government, in particular the federal government, that's another area that SBA is pretty well involved with. So the contracting piece is sort of the third C, if you will. So if that would be of interest for anybody to explore, you know, it could be a variety of different things. It could be IT, it could be food services, it could be construction, engineering services, and any number of different things. The federal government is the biggest procurer of you know, products and services in the world. Something to keep in mind, and so SBA just in general should be a portal for you if you're seeking any of these kinds of areas of assistance, or if you have any interest in any of this stuff, go out to the website, sba.gov. Our local website is sba.gov/WA, and you can zero in on some of these specific resources. So that's kind of my overview. I want to talk about this SBA financing now, which I think primarily, if you're somebody who's either going into business or in business now, the vast majority of the SBA financing comes through what we call the 7A guaranteed loan program. That's from Section 7A of the Small Business Act. But generally, if you hear somebody talking about getting an SBA loan, this is more than likely what we're talking about. It's a pretty big program. I think if you looked at what happened, say, last year, fiscal year 2015, there were probably 60,000 of these SBA loans approved around the country for maybe $23 or $25 billion. So it's a considerable source of funding for small businesses overall. If you sort of looked at all the different ways that people get money, this particular program is gonna be one of the more significant. So I want to talk a little bit about how the program works, give you a little feel for how you would work with a lender to possibly get one of these loans, a little bit about just some of the red tape aspects of the program as far as who might be qualified and who wouldn't be. I want to talk a little bit about why this program even exists, so you can kind of understand how you guys, as maybe small businesses, maybe potentially startup businesses, might be a fit for the program. And as I said, I then want to delve a little bit into sort of the thought process behind what lenders are doing, how they're maybe going to consider your particular situation if you have a chance to go apply for a loan or talk to them about a loan. So the idea with this 7A guaranteed loan program is these are SBA-backed loans. They're not SBA-made loans. These are loans that are actually made available through a variety of different participating lending institutions, and by that I mean most of the lenders out there in the community that you can think of are probably authorized to make these SBA guaranteed loans, and they really run the gamut from the large national lenders. Wells Fargo, U.S. Bank, KeyBank, for example, are all very good, active, competent SBA lenders. At the same time, though, we have, and this is what we really like, there are a lot of community banks and now even some credit unions that are participating in the program. And then there are a variety of different banks that are sort of in between, maybe more of the regional size lenders, but the ones that are still sort of tied into the community, Banner Bank and Columbia Bank and Heritage Bank come to mind as being very capable SBA lenders. So if you ask your kind of generally ask the question of, hey, who makes SBA loans? Most of the lenders out there do that. I would bring your attention to our website again, that www.sba.gov/WA. If you go to that, you'll actually, and kind of scroll down the page and have a little bit of patience, you can get to lender activity kinds of reports. And that would tell you, and I think this can be pretty useful information, especially if you're in the market for a loan. It'll give you an idea of the lenders that are actively participating in the program, and that might sort of inform your decision as to who you might want to go talk to about SBA financing. So a lot of lenders are doing these loans. The idea is we're providing a guarantee on loans made by these different lending institutions, sort of like an insurance policy, probably like the way that the VA program works. We're backing the lender in this proposition up to 85%. Generally, these are going to be 75% guarantees. But the idea is the lender is going to look at a particular situation, and there may be some applications that they'd like to entertain, but their credit requirements, their sort of risk tolerance, if you will, just don't quite allow them to do that. Maybe it's because it's a new business. Maybe it's because it's a situation where there isn't sufficient collateral to secure the loan. Maybe it's a case where they might be able to provide some financing, but it would be on terms that just wouldn't work for you as maybe an early stage business. Well, if the lender can bring in the SBA guarantee, sometimes that gives them the flexibility, sort of from a risk perspective, to offer that loan to you, even though it might have the kinds of deficiencies that I just mentioned. Lenders love to see historical repayment histories, but certainly startup businesses aren't going to have that. But as a startup business owner, I'm looking at you because it sounded like you were looking to start maybe a bar?
Brewery. Sorry, it's in business.
Oh, it's in business now. Okay, great. Okay, so they may look at that and say, well, you got a great resume, great background, great business plan. You've even got a pretty reasonable amount of your own money going into this thing. You got a good credit history, but we just can't make loans to startups because we need to see some kind of history of repayment. So the idea is by bringing in that SBA guarantee, we're reducing the lender's exposure significantly. You know, sometimes as much to as little as 15% if it was an 85% guarantee. And so then ultimately, even though their conventional approach would say, hey, we can't make that loan, if they look at it in the context of this SBA guaranteed loan program, they might be able to. And the same thing could hold true for things like inadequacy of collateral. You know, they might think, well, we would typically want to know that we're going to have a full repayment from the assets that are going to secure the loan. But in a lot of cases with SBA loans, that's not going to happen. There are a lot of service and retail types of businesses out there. They're good businesses, good owners, good operators, but the collateral isn't there. That's another reason that lenders would look and say, okay, wait a minute, but if we can have a little different calculation if we can bring in the backing of SBA. So that's kind of what's going on there. And why we do that. Ultimately, if there's a default on one of these loans, the way that it works is that SBA expects the lender to collect on the loan to the extent possible, as much as they can. And then at the end of that process, they would have the ability to go to SBA and say, we've done everything we can, please honor your guarantee. And so in the case of, say, an 85% guaranteed loan, we would pay the bank 85% of the outstanding balance on the loan at that time. So that's sort of the mechanics of how that backing actually would ultimately play out. Most of the SBA loans that get done, quite frankly, they don't go like that. Most of them are successful. So these are good loans that have these little deficiencies that lenders can't quite get their heads around, and we by providing this enhancement, if you will, help them to get comfortable with these deals. And so I talked about the different kinds of cases where it kind of makes sense for lenders to look for the SBA guarantee. You know, other issues besides the collateral and the lack of payment history that are really common. You guys as business owners or potential business owners, you're probably going to hope to, if you do decide, hey, I need a loan, you're going to hope to have it structured in a way that it doesn't sort of decimate your cash flow. You know, you're going to want to probably extend out the payments as much as you can. Lenders are always thinking just the opposite, I think. They'd like to get repaid as quickly as possible. So we have this sort of tension there between the typical small business owner and the typical lender. So again, the SBA guarantee can come in and sort of bridge that gap a little bit. And so we, by providing that guarantee, allow lenders to get comfortable with the idea of things like, oh, I don't know, like a 10-year maturity for an equipment loan, whereas you might find three-year financing out there if you were to do it conventionally. Even up to 7 years for working capital, so like a term loan for working capital could be available through the SBA program. Commercial real estate, if you get to that point, can go out as far as 25 years, and these are going to be fully amortized loans, which is not typical in a conventional lending framework. So we're allowing lenders to get comfortable with a structure that they wouldn't otherwise be able to provide. But ultimately, the idea is it's going to be to the benefit of the small business. A little bit about the program parameters. Maximum SBA loan can go up to as much as $5 million. There's no minimum loan amount. I think generally speaking, you probably don't see a lot of these kinds of loans getting done for less than $50,000, but it that doesn't mean that it can't be done. We provide sort of some constraints on our lenders as far as interest rates on SBA loans, so they can't simply say, well, gee, this is a loan that we wouldn't have made otherwise. We're getting the SBA guarantee, but we're going to really jack up the interest rate to kind of make up for it. They can't do that. So basically, and they wouldn't want to. These are good people who are looking to have a positive arrangement with small businesses, and so they're limited. Though, typically, what we're looking at is a variable rate structure on interest rates on SBA loans, and it's going to range between prime plus 2.25 up to prime plus 2.75 as far as the maximum rates available for lenders. I think the prime rate right now is 3.5. So if you were to get an SBA guaranteed loan at this point, you'd be looking at a starting rate of 6.25. So we're still kind of in that historically low rate environment. But suffice it to say, I think it's an important point from a planning perspective that most of the SBA loans are variable rate. And so you would want to maybe consider what would happen if that underlying interest rate, which is typically the prime rate, were to go up, and what the kind of an impact that might have on your payment and your cash flow. We do charge a guarantee fee. It's typically financed, and it's going to range between 2% and 3.5% of the guaranteed portion of the loan. And as I mentioned, maturities on SBA loans are tied to the sort of use of proceeds, but they can be quite generous. If you're somebody who's looking to go into business by buying a business, or if you're in business now looking to maybe buy a competitor, oftentimes you're going to be purchasing goodwill or intangible assets. That kind of a project can be financed over as much as 10 years. And so, again, the idea here is to give, I think, businesses some breathing room as far as how much time they have to amortize this debt, and hopefully give them the ability to keep as much liquidity as possible in the business. I think SBA loans, I always kind of just tell people that they can be useful at any point in time in the typical business life cycle. And so that goes from the startup phase all the way out to the mature business. I think that startup situation, oftentimes people are going to be looking at SBA financing for things like that permanent working capital to sort of absorb the cost of operations for the first few months until you get to hopefully that break-even point, but also to fund things like furniture and fixtures and tenant improvements. Very common purposes as far as SBA financing. If you're somebody that's been in business for a while, you might be looking to acquire facilities. You might be looking to acquire a larger line of equipment. You might be looking to acquire a competitor. Any of those things are possible with SBA financing as well. And if you're somebody that's maybe been around for a long time, we'll see people that maybe are carrying some debt on their books that's particularly high interest. The possibility exists to refinance that debt with an SBA guaranteed loan. We see people that are maybe in business with somebody else, and that somebody else wants to retire, and so there's possibly an opportunity for a buyout situation that could certainly be financed with an SBA backed loan as well. So there are a lot of different things that can be done with SBA financing. I think it's interesting to talk about the idea of early stage or startup businesses. I think there's generally a sense that it's very, very, very difficult for startups to get financing, even through the SBA guarantee program. But I would say it's not impossible. And so we look at our sort of 0 to 2 year time frame and categorize those types of businesses as startups. And my slide indicates that about 1 in 4 of all of the SBA loans that are done go to those kinds of businesses. So, and some of them are true startups. They certainly have to have their ducks in a row, but it is possible. And there are lenders that I know right now that I could talk to about very specific transactions for startup businesses. And so it is not inconceivable, despite what the sort of, I think, common perception is. This, and I apologize if it's difficult to see you guys. I just, and I also apologize for the datedness of the information. It's 2014. I needed to probably have that updated. But the point is that I just simply wanted to show you some of the different kinds of businesses and industries in our area, what we call the Seattle District, that have been beneficiaries of SBA financing. And so this kind of gives you a sense of some of the different sectors. You see we got a lot of service and retail types of businesses, hospitality types of businesses. There are, despite what you probably hear a lot about is how much lenders dislike the idea of financing restaurants. The reality of it is that there are a lot of restaurant transactions done, and this information kind of supports that. So that's sort of interesting. I think it's the sort of classical entrepreneurial endeavor, and I think that we're in an area where there's a lot of that going on anyway. Some of those are full service, some of them are limited service, some of them are franchises, but it's a pretty common area for SBA financing. Other kinds of businesses, though, in recent years that have really sort of gained a lot of traction as far as SBA financing, construction trade related businesses, certainly in the last 4 or 5 years, have been big recipients of SBA financing. Also professional practices, whether we're talking about doctors or dentists or veterinarians or chiropractors or financial services types of businesses as well. Certainly insurance companies would fall into that category, that we see a lot of folks that are looking to start those kinds of businesses or acquire those kinds of businesses that are getting the benefit of SBA guaranteed financing. And the reason that generally is happening is in a lot of those cases there are intangible assets being financed, and as I kind of mentioned earlier, sometimes that's a difficult thing for lenders to deal with if they don't have the benefit of the SBA guarantee. So but it's interesting, and certainly the list of businesses is way, way longer. This was just to give you a little snapshot of some of the more popular types of industries. I'm not going to talk much about 7A SBA loan eligibility. Suffice it to say there are a couple of areas that are problematic as far as getting SBA financing. And one is that we have a thing about owner occupancy or owner occupied businesses. So if you're somebody that's looking to maybe acquire a building for your business, we want to make sure that it's a building for the business and not a building just to lease out. And so if it's an existing building, for example, you'd have to occupy at least 51% of the rentable space. We also want to make sure that you're not somebody that's engaged in some type of business that doesn't fit within SBA's parameters. So any kind of investment or speculation types of businesses, they might be great businesses. They just don't fit within our parameters. We're trying to focus this program on more actively engaged businesses and maybe those that ultimately are going to create some jobs. The other couple of things there, we have a rule called the credit elsewhere certification, and that's something that when a lender submits an application to SBA, they are certifying that in their opinion that the financing they're proposing with the SBA guarantee wouldn't be available if not for the SBA guarantee. So essentially what it says is that if the owners of a business who's applying for SBA financing are wealthy, they're not going to pass that test. So if the sources of financing are available elsewhere, or if the owners of the business could fund the proposal themselves without any hardship, then they wouldn't pass that credit elsewhere test. We usually don't, I personally don't have that problem, and I'm you guys probably don't either, you know, the idea of being too rich for SBA financing. So, because you can be reasonably well off. It's not like we're looking to make paupers out of people. So, but it's something to keep in mind. This idea of character as an eligibility thing, we're talking here about SBA has kind of built into our forms. We ask people to disclose if they've had any criminal history. And generally, if there is anything, it's something that we can work through, but it does have to be addressed. The other sort of character piece, if you will, is lenders in particular are looking at personal credit histories and credit scores and those kinds of things. So those are important considerations as well. A little bit about the process, you know, so again, it's not a loan made by SBA, so you don't go to the SBA office necessarily to get application documents or anything like that. You really are going to choose or identify the lender of your choice, and you're going to make application to that lender through whatever their particular process is. Ultimately, they're going to likely be looking to get as much information from you as they can in order to make their loan decision. And then if they're going to use the SBA program, their loan decision is going to be subject to getting SBA's guarantee. So you're going to work with the bank, you're going to give them business plan, loan proposal, financial statements, tax returns, all that stuff that they're going to typically require in order to make a well-informed decision. And assuming their decision is, yes, we want to make this loan, but we need the SBA to guarantee it, they'll approve the loan subject to the SBA guarantee, and then they will seek the guarantee from SBA on your behalf. Sometimes that's just as a very abbreviated electronic process. Sometimes it's a little more involved, but in any case, it's an interaction between the bank and SBA, so you don't have to deal with our agency at all. SBA then would communicate back to the lender when the application is approved, and from there, the lender will work toward closing and dispersing that loan pretty much in the same way as they would any other business loan. So you work with the lender works with SBA. So there's, again, not that we don't want to talk to you guys, because I'd be happy to, but from a loan perspective or the actual application, there's no interaction between the business or applicant and SBA specifically. So here's another one that's really hard to read, but the idea here is I just wanted to show, this is kind of a loan program matrix, if you will, and the idea that I wanted to communicate is that, again, these SBA loans can be used for a lot of different things, and so in addition to all the stuff that I was talking about as far as buying businesses or buying commercial real estate or working capital for startup businesses, there's some more specific ways that the program can be used. And so within that, for example, if you're a business that has a need for short-term financing, like a line of credit for your business. There are sort of sub-programs of our guarantee program that would allow for that, that would allow a lender to make a line of credit available to your business with an SBA guarantee. If you're somebody maybe that, for example, is looking to sell your product or service overseas, there are some specific ways that the SBA guarantee program can be used that would facilitate that kind of international trade. So we have something called the, for example, the Export Working Capital Program. We have another program called the Export Express Program. And so these are designed to specifically support foreign sales and all of the activity related to that. If you're somebody that maybe is doing business with a government entity and you have government contracts that you're performing on, there's a specific SBA program out there for that purpose as well, where SBA can guarantee loans made by participating lending institutions to fund the upfront costs associated with performance on that government contract. And all the lender needs in exchange for that is an assignment of the government contract. So it can be a very unique arrangement for lenders, but it also could potentially allow you to get access to funding that wouldn't otherwise be available. So again, bottom line is there are a lot of these different kinds of variations of the SBA program. One of the other ones, somewhere in here, we have something called the Veterans Advantage, and the idea there is that SBA has designed our guaranteed loan program to provide some relief as far as the guarantee fee for businesses that are owned by veterans or spouses of veterans. So for example, for an SBA loan all the way up to $5 million, the typical SBA guarantee fee is cut in half for folks in that situation. Bottom line is there are a lot of different ways that the SBA program can be used. And a lot of little different nuances to it. Another one that comes to mind right now, if you're somebody that might be in the market for SBA financing through the remainder of fiscal year 2016, which is September 30th, the guarantee fee on any of these loans up to $150,000 is waived. So that would typically be probably $2,000 or something like that if it was a $150,000 loan. That is currently waived. SBA is very interested in and concerned with the idea of making sure that some of the more modest sized financing needs are being met. As I said, the SBA loan maximum can go out as far as $5 million. But we want to make sure that those worthy candidates for financing for maybe $50,000 or $100,000 are getting their needs met as well. So this is a way to maybe drive a little bit of activity in that regard. There's also some fee benefits to the lending institutions that are involved in these as well. So, okay, this is where I'm just going to talk a little bit about what lenders are kind of looking for. And I think that this maybe helps folks that are thinking about going and talking with a funder about their need and about you know, their whole story, why they should be recipients of financing, how they're going to pay the money back. That's ultimately what lenders are concerned about is answering that question. You know, is there a reasonable likelihood that you're going to be able to repay the loan? So there are a lot of different things that they look at, but I think you can kind of boil it down into these five little areas. And so I'm going to just sort of breeze through this. Lenders sometimes call this the five C's of credit. So a little bit about that. So capacity, and here we're really talking about management capacity, and the ability of you as the owner of the business, or you and your team, to be able to successfully operate the business, to operate it in a profitable manner. And sometimes that's a difficult thing to demonstrate, especially if you have an early stage or a startup business. And so, some of the things that I think people can look to or rely upon in trying to make the case for themselves as being having the capacity to be successful, I've sort of cited a few things. You know, the best thing probably is management, successful management experience in the same industry, but not everybody's going to have that. So you might have a combination of things. It might be a matter of having a particular technical credentials or technical skills or a particular educational background, or surrounding yourself with a number of key individuals who are going to be able to augment the strengths that you bring to the management, could be any number of different approaches. But the bottom line is you want to make sure that what you're presenting, the way that you present yourself on paper as well as in person, is that you are somebody that's absolutely going to be able to make the kinds of decisions that are going to lead to a successful outcome in the business and ultimately on repaying the loan. So cash flow. So here we're really talking about a couple of different scenarios. If it's an existing business versus cash flow, if it's a startup business, cash flow is really, lenders are kind of looking at, okay, how much after all your expenses are paid is going to be available to service the debt. And if it's a startup business, that can be a trickier proposition, because we're really talking about projections. And so that's a whole nother thing. But you want to be in a position where you can confidently explain those projections if it is a startup situation, where your numbers came from, where your margins came from, and if you can't do that, that's going to be difficult. So that's where, again, I would sort of loop back to the idea of, hey, where do you get that? That's great, Mark, for you to tell us that we need to be able to defend our projections, but how do I actually kind of get to that? I would refer you guys again back to the idea of some of those resources, whether it's SCORE and their business planning workshop, or whether it's the Small Business Development Center and their research capabilities, where they could actually go out and help you maybe identify what would be a reasonable level of revenue for a particular type of business within a certain geographic market. There are people out there that can help you with this. But the bottom line is you want to make sure that those numbers aren't just sort of arbitrarily pulled out of the air. You know, oftentimes people will rely on industry data, and that's certainly an appropriate way to go as well. But be in a position where you can confidently articulate and sort of defend, the assumptions behind those projections, because that's kind of all the lender is going to have to really look at as far as being able to determine your ability to have enough money to make the monthly payment on that SBA loan. It's an easier proposition when we're talking about an existing business, especially if it's an existing business that has been profitable. Lenders will look back at typically the last 3 years of operations and try and see whether or not there's sufficient cash flow there after paying all the expenses to service the requested debt. Sometimes it might be there, other times it wouldn't be there. If it isn't there, then you're back into the projection situation where you need to make that case. So a little bit more about this idea of character and credit, and really from a lender perspective, it's about the credit score. You hear it all the time, more and more and more, how important it is to know what in fact is on your credit report, and especially if you guys are getting to the point where you're going to go actually have a conversation with a lender. I think it's important to understand that once you sign that application document, that's probably one of the first things they're going to do is pull your credit. And so with that in mind, I think it's good to know what's on your credit report up front and be candid about it. There's no reason not to. They're going to find out what's there anyway. And if there are issues, it doesn't necessarily have to be a deal breaker. There are different kind of lenders out there that are going to have different levels of sensitivity about this. But there could certainly be explainable situations where somebody might have credit problems or issues in their credit history that were beyond their control, for example. But lenders want to know that whatever the issue was, it's been resolved one way or the other. You've taken the necessary steps to deal with it, and you've moved forward and demonstrated that you are continuing to honor your obligations going forward. Especially for startup businesses, it's really important because otherwise they're just looking at projections. So this is a real legitimate data point for lenders to consider, and they can say, well, this is the person that's going to own the business. What has been their history in handling their obligations? So it kind of makes sense that it would be particularly important in those cases. But be candid about it, be upfront. And again, not all lenders are going to treat these issues the same way. So persevere and don't get discouraged if there is some kind of a ding out there, because a lot of people have that. What about this idea of financing 100%? What are lenders going to be willing to fund all of your needs, or are they going to be actually looking for some kind of a shared arrangement? Well, the reality of it is they're looking for a shared arrangement. They don't generally want to finance 100% of a project, especially if it's a startup situation. That's just simply not realistic. They want to know that you as an owner have a reasonable stake in the business, and that's important psychologically, because you have a actual commitment that you're showing and that you're making. But it's also important sort of financial analysis wise. It's an indicator of stability in the business going forward if you actually have some equity in the business. So what are we talking about? We're actually talking about, you know, the idea of putting cash into the deal. If it's going to take $150,000, let's say, to start your business, you should be thinking about probably somewhere between 20% and 30% of that money should be coming from you, and then the rest conceivably could come in the form of some kind of a small business bank loan. So in that case, we'd be talking $30,000, $40,000 maybe from the business owner as a reasonable equity contribution. How do you get that if you don't already have it? That's a whole nother question, but we certainly have seen a lot of different SBA situations where people have raised money different ways, from family, friends, relatives, either in the form of promissory notes or small equity positions in the business, and that's definitely a possibility. That would count just the same for a lender, and certainly for SBA, as far as being a legitimate equity contribution. Other times we've seen people that actually have assets that can be incorporated into the business. Maybe you have some type of service business and you've already got a truck, and you can validate the truck as having a certain value right now. That would be a legitimate equity contribution. So there are different ways that can be approached, but understand that it's really important for you to be realistic about it. Don't get too far down the road and have a substantial financing need with no money of your own going into it. It's just not going to work out for you. Collateral is, as I mentioned, oftentimes the reason why lenders would be looking for SBA to guarantee the loan in the first place, that there isn't enough collateral to give them a secondary source of repayment in the deal if the loan should go bad. So having said that, it's still important for businesses to understand that that with these SBA loans, we're expecting our lenders to secure them as well as possible. So even though oftentimes they're not fully secured, we want to make sure that they're as well secured as can be. So oftentimes what that typically means is lenders are going to take a lien on the assets that are being financed in the business, and guarantees by owners of 20% or more of the business itself. And if the business assets are not sufficient to secure the loan, and the owners happen to have outside assets that would be available to be pledged, that could be a possibility as well. So some of these SBA loans end up getting secured by business assets and maybe like by a second deed of trust on a house. So I just want to get you in a frame of mind where you're being realistic about the commitment here. There's no there's no particular benefit of the SBA guarantee as far as the commitment required of the owners of the business. It's the same as if it were any other kind of business loan. The benefit of the SBA guarantee is that it allows for the financing to occur in the first place. So final thoughts. You know, I just think it's important if you are getting to the point of maybe going and talking to a lender, be prepared, think about what's important to them, some of those things that we just talked about with the five C's and so on. Have your documentation sort of ready to go. I think it's pretty standard that lenders are going to want to see things like a current personal financial statement, 3 years of tax returns. If you're in business now, a current business financial statement and probably 3 years of tax returns on the business. If it's a startup, have that business plan document ready. If it's an existing business, some kind of financing proposal that pretty clearly sets out exactly what you're looking to do. You know, understand that volume isn't necessarily gonna result in success. I think you're trying to be succinct with that information. At the same time, though, you want to answer some of the questions that the lender would logically be asking. So yeah, that's kind of really what I wanted to drive home was the idea of understanding where that lender's coming from, what's important to them, and presenting something that they can fairly easily digest. And then as they start to ask questions or think of questions going forward, that's great, and that's all part of the process. But have something that's going to make it easier for them so that they don't have to continue to go back and forth with you to try to develop this information. Go ahead and anticipate what they're going to be looking for up front. I think you're just going to be that much better off. So I talked about these different resources already, you guys, but keep it in mind, SCORE, Small Business Development Center, Women's Business Center, and also the Veteran Business Outreach Center are all available and potentially great resources for you in this process. And with that, I think I'm done. So does anybody have any questions?
Yeah, Mark, I was just wondering, one of the slides you had was the quick reference sheet.
Right,
was so much there that we could hardly see it.
It was.
Is that available on the SBA website?
It is. I wonder if there'd be a way I can get it to you. And yeah. Yeah, it's a nice little handout, and it's probably most beneficial to lenders just because they can kind of look at it real quick and say, okay, for this kind of loan, what are the fee parameters or whatever. But at the same time, for businesses or service providers, same thing. I mean, you can say, hey, SBA actually has something that might support, for example, that contract financing is an interesting one.
Right.
So, yeah.
Good.
Okay. All right. Thanks very much. I really appreciate the opportunity.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Mark. My takeaway is clearly the government wants you to succeed in business no matter who you are. There's a program for you. So go to the SBA website and investigate what your options are. So with that, that concludes our program today. I want to thank you all for attending, and we hope you have found the presented information informative and helpful. Again, I want to thank Mayor Backus and the City Council for their support, and our partners with the Auburn Area Chamber of Commerce, and of course, the Auburn Downtown Association. I just wanted to remind you that you'll be able to access the video of today's program at www.auburnwa.gov, and we hope you will share this program with other members of your team as well. Have a great day.